Yes, yes. What's up? Welcome back to Ill Communication. Oh, cat cameo.
Yeah, turtle. She heard you calling it out.
Yeah, I'm joined today by Kraddy and what's your
turtle.
Cat's name?
This is Turtle.
Turtle, how's
what's up,
it going?
Turtle? Say hi to all the peeps.
Meow.
She's played some parts on some songs. She likes to walk on the keyboard a lot, and sometimes she comes up with cool shit, honestly.
That's, it's important to stretch your brain, come up with stuff that you wouldn't come up with otherwise.
Yeah, I like systems where, like, you almost kind of, it's like one of those things where you, like, drop the ball down the, what are those things called? Rube Goldberg and you make a song by just, I just have the cat walk on the keyboard, and then whatever they get out of that, I just use that.
I remember I saw this dude who had put together an all hamster powered sequencer, and he had three or four hamsters in like this vertical hamster maze, and where they were would modulate all the parameters and stuff. And I was like, what am I doing with my life? You know, it really
I saw those. I saw those hamsters at Ibiza. It was awesome.
Hey, thank you for taking the time out of your schedule to join us. I'm really stoked about this record we made, man.
Me too, dude. It's really cool.
I had Will on and Ian on, and it's been a great project. It really has, and I'm so stoked about the final result. It's something I think what we can all be real proud of, and I know I'm gonna play the shit out of mine when lockdown ends.
Yeah, I know, dude, me too. I'm dying to play those out. So many of them they're all so good. Each one could work in a different environment.
I'm close to the end of lockdown too. I'm almost like, oh shit, I gotta finish up all my lockdown projects before the world goes back to normal.
Where are you, in Vancouver?
For now, I mean, having a giant 5,000 square foot studio for guests all the time was very not workable during lockdown, especially losing my main job as a touring musician. So we ended up moving to Vancouver, and we got this killer house in this great neighborhood, and we still have guest rooms and guest studios and stuff. And I got a piano that I've been practicing, and that's been pretty good. And it's been really good, man. Been really, reading a lot and taking.
Yeah,
a lot
so you're doing
care
a book a week, right?
Books. I've read only two physical books so far, but
yeah, no, audiobooks is how I do it too. Yeah.
You can, listen while you're running or doing the dishes or trying to sleep or whatever. And it all just sort of adds up to books getting done. It's been really good. So what are you reading lately?
So I told you earlier, I read the book of The Making of the Onion. I read a book about white supremacy in America, real knee slapper. I just downloaded the book for Alan Turing, like his biography, which was turned into the movie, The Imitation Game. I've always felt after seeing the movie, and I actually in Glasgow, there's a monument to him in a park. I've always felt a kinship with Alan Turing, and just he was so mistreated, and so it's so sad.
That's definitely a terrible, terrible, beautiful story.
Yeah.
That's cool, man. So what else has been getting you through lockdown? Like, you got any projects that you're working on or any
I feel like I've been really creative because without any input, I feel like you're probably like this too. Without like input, I self-generate. So I'm like, I will get sit around and watch a TV show or a movie, but then I just get restless and I will almost like under protest, I'll start writing music. I'm just like, whatever. I just need to do something. I've been writing and I've been writing music. I've been writing a lot of down tempo stuff actually. Like moody, chill, kind of melancholy stuff that I'm think I'm going to release under another name or something. I don't really know, honestly.
Yeah, you... I've been
I've
been listening to like loads more really out there music because it's like, you know, when you're out traveling and on the road, it's like I get exposed to all these like really cool, you know, dance music artists all the time, and I'll come home and like, you know, look them up and everything, and that'll lead me down its rabbit hole. But I found like you know, in lockdown, my rabbit hole has been, you know, self-generating, and man, I've been listening to all this like microtonal music lately.
I saw you post about that. What is really up with microtonal music? Like it's not 12 notes in a scale kind of thing.
An infinite number of ways to divide an octave into pitches, and many other cultures, non-Western cultures, have different methods than the 12 tone equal temperament scale, and then there are many people who've kind of like made their own scales, and these methods have been like famously employed by Aphex Twin and you know, many others to create harmonies and melodies that you could never play on the piano that are quite interesting. But there's this dude Sevish who is like all about microtonal music, and he's got like four or five albums that I've listened to that are fucking wild, like really, really cool, like super listenable, really well produced. And
like what genre would you put it in?
It's kind of like, you know, analog drum and bass modular synth music.
Okay.
But you know, it's more it's more on the kind of like down tempo jazz type side and less on the like, you know, raging dance floor drum and bass. But but yeah, it's really cool. And then there's a lot of really good microtonal, like kind of lo-fi type stuff out there. But yeah, Adam Neely made a bunch of YouTube videos where he's making microtonal lo-fi, and it's kind of like a thing now. I don't know how much of a thing it was before him, but it's definitely a thing now. But yeah, it's pretty good. It really, like the lo-fi genre and the wonkiness of it kind of lends itself a lot to microtonal music. But yeah,
so I can see that.
Yeah, I've been exploring how to incorporate that into my own music and just listening to all kinds of really wild weird shit. Have you been listening to any new stuff that's been inspiring you? Or
I've been you know, honestly, I've been listening to a ton of dub music, which I think has kind of gotten me in a chilled out zone. It's kind of, I like the no lyrics, and it's like I don't know, there's just something magical to me about reggae music. And then dub music is, you know, is like the granddaddy to electronic music. It kind of, you know, it's like the first kind of iteration of like using the mixing board as an instrument. And from there it was like off to the races, right? So I love all that stuff. But I actually try to listen, like I was listening to, like I listened to Bauer's new album, which was nominated. I listened to a lot of the Grammy nominated albums just to listen to it, like Thundercat's album.
She was dancing around the kitchen like she was in Thundercat.
Do you know this guy, Jacob Collier?
Really famous on YouTube and stuff. I've watched tons of his
yeah, and he's like videos. He's like a kind of music math genius. He's perfect pitch and he can sing chords and stuff or whatever. But he's really cool. And I was stoked to see that he won a Grammy, and I like checking out his stuff because it's so like mentally, like he did this one song where he went from standard from 440 tuning to what's the other normal tuning. I forget, but he basically has the song switch the tuning.
Everybody's really into the 432 tuning, was it that
yeah
one?
So he went from like 440 to 432 over the course of the song. It's really cool. Like I like a lot of the stuff about like how music affects your brain. Like I really think it's the beautiful thing to me is that it bypasses everything. It bypasses all your logic and everything. And it's just, it gets right to the heart of things. That's what's so cool about music.
Sick.
Yeah.
Sick. Yeah, I'm really excited to see you know, so many of the like kind of internet breakout stars starting to finally break into things like the Oscars and the Grammys and stuff. Cause it used to be, you know, if you made a Netflix movie, you were just like ineligible for any kind of
right.
Any kind of props, you know, or like when they wouldn't allow Tron to get a VFX award because they use computers and that was cheating, you know, back then. Like it's so so short-sighted, but yeah, it's really cool to see some of these YouTubers really making inroads into the official music world.
I mean, that is the future. Everyone who's it's amazing to me. It's like people are producing movies and albums and everything, just, you know, in spaces like me and you have always been working in, like your studio or just a side room in your house or your living room or whatever it is. But it's all, you can do all of it.
Yeah, it's amazing, man.
Yeah.
And I think like one of my favorite words I learned when I was, I did a crypto benefit with these people that were getting all of the charities out there to start accepting cryptocurrency. Mm. So they had this benefit called D3. And they introduced me to my new favorite word, which is disintermediate, which is when you get rid of the middleman.
Oh, okay.
And we're seeing technology disintermediate the music and film space right now. But I'm just
it
like,
is. And the NFT thing, the art space, it's totally the NFT thing is totally that, you know.
Logo is in the Beeple one.
I'm saw so that. Stoked. That's yeah. cool.
Yeah, we worked together cool. way back in 2012. I brought him to his first nightclub.
Really?
Yeah.
What did you guys work together on?
I just hit him up because I was a VJ. You know, I've always been into VJing. And
right.
I really liked his stuff. So I hit him up like way, way, way back. And yeah, he just for one of his dailies did a little animated version of my logo and sent it back to Be Cool. But I was like, oh, that's awesome.
Cool.
Yeah, so all these people are like, oh, you know, he owes you approximately this amount of money. You should go collect royalties and stuff. I'm like, that would make me a dick. I don't want to be a dick. Like,
you should invoice him.
I'm not gonna invoice him. yeah, that would be annoying. I know some people who've like, you know, gotten rich and like it's like everybody just starts coming at you with palms out, man. It ruins your life.
It can. It definitely can.
Man, one of my favorite get rich stories.
The most of the heavy lifting in the track is done by this one drum kit. A lot of people will just continuously ignore drum sound design for like, you know, huge portions of their career. They'll wonder why their music isn't like hitting people right, you know? And it's like, we don't want to hear you play someone else's beat. You know, we want to hear your beat. Now, once you know how to make them, and you understand that it's easy, because it is easy once you do the course, then your tracks are going to be so much more expressive, and they're going to have a real authentic texture that is undeniably yours, where you can speak and express yourself through the drums.
It definitely can.
Man, one of my favorite get rich stories was this, there was this dude who in England who was a road worker, and he won the lottery, but it was like £1 million or something, right? And he goes up to everyone at work and he's like, fuck you, fuck you, fuck you, always hated you, I'm rich, I'm out, and proceeds to, like, divorces his wife, tells everyone at work to fuck off, and nice. Immediately blows all of the money on hookers and coke in like 6 months. And then he comes and asks for his whole job back.
Oh, damn.
Oh, it's hysterical. Like, hysterical. Yeah. So,
that's harsh.
Yeah, it's easy. It's easy to look at people who get a bunch of money as like a big windfall, as though it's like awesome. But apparently, especially for lottery winners, it can totally ruin your life.
There's a documentary about that called Lucky, where they follow 5 lottery winners, and all of them, except for one, all of them, it fucks up their lives.
Check that out. That sounds really interesting.
The one guy is very together, and he actually is super generous, and he like he helps people, his friends buy houses. Like he'll put the down payment on their house and help them. And it's pretty cool. The other people though, completely the guy divorces his wife and everyone manages to lose all the money basically.
Yeah. Cause money, you think that there's like amounts of money you could never spend. Nope. You could spend it. You could spend it.
Sure.
Yeah. It's pretty wild. That's pretty wild. Word. Okay, cool. So, have you got any new music that we should know about?
Like of my own
down tempo thing, but have there been any releases or any like scoring work that you're proud of that you want to share with us? Or?
I've been doing a lot of movie trailers recently. I did. We got one for The Boys, which is that TV show.
Yo.
Yeah, it's a good show. I did a remix of this James Brown Superbad, and it's gotten used in The Boys trailer, and it's gotten used in this trailer for The Equalizer with Queen Latifah.
Dude.
And there's a couple things that are like, hopefully we land, but it's like, you know, in the works. I've been working on new Kraddy stuff too. I have like a bunch of demos that I'm putting together.
Cool. So yeah. is it like, you know, because I mean, your sound is like a very kind of recognizable style. Is it like, you know, classic Kraddy vibe? Is there a twist of some kind?
It's like, there's definitely a couple tracks that are classic Kraddy vibes, but I'm trying to branch out because I just feel like, you have to innovate and change. I can't just keep writing those kinds of tracks, although they're fun, but they almost feel like I'm doing the same trick. So I've actually been just getting inspiration from a lot of different people, just listening to different artists, new people, old people, like, you know, all different styles, just kind of, I think you do the same thing, just trying to jog my brain and like find something just where I'm like, oh, this is weird. Also, Instagram, a lot of Instagram videos and stuff, or TikTok videos people do. Like sometimes there's a little sound in there I try to grab. I'm kind of like in that mode where I'm just like pulling from all directions.
I'll search like YouTube Vine compilations a lot. Vine had a lot of the best samples I find because the videos like forced you to be 5 seconds long. So
that's a good idea. I never thought about that. Yeah.
Now, but there's people who put together compilations of Vines and stuff where there's some good stuff. Cool. So, you know, I've been thinking a lot about style lately and about like the importance of style to making music that resonates with people. And, you know, especially teaching, there's a lot of people who are really trying to find their style, you know, whether it's like visual or musical or fashion or what. And I think, you know, when I think of Kraddy, you have a very clearly defined style. Can you tell us a little bit about like how did you find that style, and were there like, you know, kind of first pancakes along the way?
First pancakes, that's a good term. Yeah, I mean, definitely. I mean, I had hundreds of tracks that are just, you know, just flat, just, you know, whatever kind of tracks. I think it was, this is a good story, actually. When I drove out to California, I drove out with a friend of mine from New York, where I'm from. And we drove all the way across the country. And we stopped in Salt Lake City at one point. And I remember he was driving, you know, Salt Lake City, you're almost in California. We got stoned. We were listening to Aphex Twin. I forget if it was like Ambient Works or I Care Because You Do. I think it was I Care Because You Do. And we were driving across the salt flats in Utah, which are just so crazy. And I just remember hearing his music, and it just, we were big hip hop heads and everything was like about hip hop. That's probably what we listened to most of the trip. But for this one moment, we were listening to Aphex Twin, and it all kind of like fused in my head. And I was like, I want to take like hip hop and give it this Aphex Twin, whatever you want to call that. I don't know what that is, but you know, Aphex Twin is so unique and so cool. And it's like, it's always fascinates me how many people relate to him. Whereas his vibe is, you don't feel like he cares whether you're relating to him or not. You know what I mean? So anyways, I feel like that's where it started. And I wanted to just fuse those two. And then I'm kind of, and then I think I'm just a sucker for like heavy classic rock guitar riffs, coming up with like Led Zeppelin. And I was, you know, way into metal and hardcore and all that kind of stuff. So I'm a sucker for like chuggy guitar, you know, the slow and reggae and dub, and it's all like bass, chuggy kind of heavy stuff. So I think it just sort of evolved. I didn't really like, there was no like, okay, I need to define my style. It just sort of came together. And it just, then, you know, I got introduced to Ed, who through a mutual friend, Steve Nalepa. And we were doing the same thing. We both basically were trying to fuse hip hop and like Aphex Twin or Square Pusher. And Aphex Twin was my first like introduction to that style of dance music or that style of electronic music. And then from there, Square Pusher. And then, you know, obviously I started just finding all this stuff. It's just, it's funny the way it all just like fell together. It's, when you look back on it, it seems like it makes sense. But at the time, it's just all, you know, it's just like, who knows?
Yeah.
I was just putting a lot of distortion on stuff and you know, just playing. I was making music on my home stereo speakers, my parents' home stereo speakers from like the 70s, because that's all I had. So, yeah. That probably helped define my sound, because I was just making it on these speakers that are like, they were just like, they had some low end to them, honestly. Those old speakers, they were heavy as fuck.
There's some hi-fis from the 70s that still sound really, really good. Like, yeah. Every now and then I'll go over to someone's house and they'll have some, like, you know, because when you get like, you know, a lot of that people, the hi-fi now has been replaced by like hi-fi computer speakers, you know, mm-hmm. like, and you know, some of those things, man, they just sound so like, there's like a harshness to them, you know, sure. Like people really, they're not engineered for sweetness. They're engineered for like full spectrum sound, but the tone is like, is not nearly as there as a lot of the really old school hi-fis. I remember even seeing like this one person on Reddit, I guess they got the model down from the top model of Logitech speakers and the tweeter fell off and it was just like wood behind it. Like it was just like a fake tweeter.
Oh, really?
To make you think that there was a tweeter there. I was like, oh damn, that's so, that's brutal.
I've seen now that they have, now I think is it Spotify or like Beatport or some of these streaming services, or maybe it's a box you buy, but they have these basically digital analog converter that will make MP3s and all that sound way fuller and way better.
Interesting.
I saw a video of people using it at NAMM.
And you can definitely hear the difference under the right listening conditions. You can definitely hear the difference, especially.
They had people on headphones who could definitely hear the difference.
And you know, whenever I'm trying to teach people like what to listen for, if you get rid of the mono signal and just listen to the sides, especially the reverb and especially the side only signal, is where it really falls apart and you get this kind of like watery mush sound.
Mm-hmm.
And once you know what that texture is and you put the mono signal back in, you can hear it.
Yeah, I know exactly what you're talking about. There's that sound. It reminds me of slushy snow.
Totally. Totally.
Yeah.
Man, I
it like seeps into your boots.
For all of a week this year, it was so cool. I had not seen snow like outside my house since I moved to the US.
Yeah.
And man, it was just like, because Vancouver is warm. Like it doesn't snow here. It's like Seattle. And I remember just like going outside and like building a snowman with Asha and like whipping snowballs at each other and stuff. And the sounds of the snow. Are
yeah,
just, like,
I love the sounds.
There's so much, like when it gets really cold, they get all sharp and stuff. Like it's just like the sound really changes depending on the temperature. It's pretty wild, man. Like there's a lot of, if you're in the market for field recordings, man, snow and ice is where it's at.
Definitely. I love those sounds.
Yeah. Super, super good. Are there any go-to textures that you've been exploring in your music?
I have this thing, I'm almost afraid to admit it, but like I have been just going to Splice or Sound or all these sample banks, and I just pull stuff out and I make myself like do it super fast. And so I just like will put something together really fast, depending on whatever I find that just piques my interest. Because I like all the recording and sound design, but it almost to me, that's like a whole nother thing. Although I do have a cool recording of a escalator on my phone that I still need to use. A lot of times I take those recordings and then I forget to use them, you know, like I end up just going to whatever samples I have on the computer at the time, just because for my creative process it just needs to be like there and ready to be used. So a lot of times the recording has to happen at some other time, because then like, you know what I mean?
To record anything but like vocals or guitar or whatever, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But all those texture sounds, man. Yeah, definitely. They're good.
But yeah, ones. I've just been that kind of, whatever I find, I just kind of will throw some effects on it or flip it backwards or do what, or pitch it up and down a lot. And just find just some way to freak it out, to change it, or just do something to it where all of a sudden, you know, the inspiration starts clicking and you're just off and running. For me, it's like a, you know, you got to get it rolling, and then I don't even, but up until that point for me creatively, it's hard. It's like, I don't know what I'm supposed to do. So I just really will just mess around, like without, there's no plan to it. There's no plan to it. If I feel like if I make a plan to it, it'll like ruin the moment. It has to happen spontaneously for me to be like pique my interest. And then I start, oh yeah, okay, I know what to do. That sounds cool with this, you know?
Yeah, I call that process finding the face, you know, where you're you're figuring out like what's the best sound? What's the sound that's like in charge? Like what's the one that's gonna make it so you know the rest of the workflow. Have you heard why loudness comes from empty space? In my Composing the Mix workshop, I will teach you how to take away from your mix to give a bigger sound and a deeper impact.
There's something about finding, like, I don't know, I think as an artist, I imagine myself like in a junkyard. And I am piecing together parts that were kind of intended for other purposes, but I'm sort of just putting it together, just making it work. And that's really appealing to me. That's why I love like Splice or Sounds, or I think one's called Arcade, because there's just all these pieces and you can just, you're like, oh, this kind of is like a pop vocal, but if I pitch it down and reverse it, it's like a moody bass sound or something. And that's where it's like exciting to me, almost more than like playing it in. Although plenty of times I'll play it in and I'll come up with cool stuff, but there's something about finding it. It's almost like turning on the television and your favorite movie's on and your favorite part, you know, you just feel like you won the lottery or something, to bring it back around. There's something, feels something magical about it. And that's exciting, you know?
So I've been thinking a lot about like kind of being more specific about the emotions that I'm trying to create with my music. Are there any kind of like specific feelings that you either find yourself expressing or that you are kind of intentional about putting into your music for your listeners to feel?
I mean, I think it's either I'm pissed off or I'm sad, which are kind of the same feeling really when you get down to it. But yeah, I think for me, that's always what it is. It's never, it's always kind of like an outlet, like a cathartic thing. I usually don't set out to with the emotion in mind, like, or at least not a strong idea of the emotion. Sometimes I can think of a person sometimes if I set out on the emotion, I'm like, I'm going to write like a angry something. When I start to do it and it's not turning out the way I imagined it, then like there becomes this like where, well, here's what I wanted and here's what's happening. And, you know, that creatively that is like, well, it gets in the way creatively. If I don't really want it to be anything, then I'm not going to have that problem. You know what I mean? I'm just like, oh, okay, this is, sometimes I do. I'm like, I'm going to write a banger. And then I'm like, oh no, this is a downtempo track. But I just am like, okay, fine. This is what it is. You know, let the, you talk a lot about this, like let the song tell you what it is and go with it. Even though if you go in like, oh, I need to write a dubstep banger and it's just not a dubstep banger. If you're trying to make it one, it's just, you're at odds with your own creativity. It's just going to end up sounding that way. So I try to go in usually, but usually what inspires me to kind of write is that initial feeling of like, man, this is fucked up. And I'm either angry about it or sad about it.
Cool. And do you have like a specific kind of audience in mind when you're writing, or like even if it's like a person, like, is there
like dancers, someone that you're, pardon? Dancers,
right.
I think about dancers. I want something that dancers would not just like professional dancers, or, you know, although I love all those people. But I mean, anyone who's like listening to this, I want them to be like, it to stoke their flame, to just like make them like have to sort of nod their head or move their ass or whatever it is. That's always what it is for me, imagining somebody, you know, I imagine like kind of DJing and I'm looking down, you have that kind of like whatever degree sort of down view of the audience. And you see that one person who it kind of clicks for them and they're like, oh, this is my jam or whatever. That's what I'm going for, like that moment, you know? So I try to like, what is going to get somebody there, you know?
Hey, speaking of dancers, I remember one time where I was like, damn, Kraddy doing it big. One of those moments was when I saw one of those dance crews on one of those talent shows. They had this like mass dance crew doing a dance to Android Porn, I believe. That was,
yeah, like, America's so best dance crew.
Yeah, that was so sick, man. So what did that feel like when that happened?
I mean, that was crazy. It was, you know, it was one of those weird things where I found out about it kind of after it happened. But yeah, it was the guys, the Ghost Crew, I think their name was, were really cool. And yeah, it's always, I'm so flattered by that stuff. Honestly, I see lots of dancer videos. There's a lot of dancer videos to my music, and I love that. I want to do more where I collaborate with dancers and make something, because yeah, like I said, that's always what I'm going for, you know. I just want like people to have that letting go feeling where they're just getting into it.
Right on.
Yeah.
So you start with angry and sad, and then you work your way to this joyous letting go.
Yeah, well, yeah, something like that, I guess. Yeah, I mean, as I'm laying it out to you right now, I've never thought about it, so it's like, yeah, I don't know. I guess that is kind of what happens. Somewhere, it just sort of it transmutes into making people happy and making me happy, but there's a powerfulness to it as well, like. I always call it victory through struggle. That's always nice. Kind of, I feel I like that's always been my music. Theme.
I hear yeah. that as a theme for sure. Yeah. Victory through struggle. That's a yeah. good victory. You know what victory just handed to you? That's
victory
like,
just handed to you. You don't ever, you're just kind of like, cool. You know, it's like free stuff. But victory through struggle is when you tell that story for the rest of your life and everything, you know, and you pin yourself, your self-identity on that, because you're like, we did this, or I got through this. I mean, usually it's a we, but sometimes it's an I, you know, you, whatever you accomplished, it's like, it was fucking hard. Because you telling a story about something that was easy is doesn't really reflect on your character or like make you feel anything so much.
really learn much about yourself.
Yeah, exactly. It's funny. We always want things to be easy, even though like when things are hard is when we always learn things, you know?
Man, one of the books that I read in my quest to read a book every week is Can't Hurt Me by this guy, David Goggins.
Yeah, I saw you write about that.
Oh, man, that guy is like, he's one of the only people that I've met that actually purposely seeks out the most challenging, most uncomfortable, most like intense struggles that he possibly can. And it's just like, it's great. It's great inspiration because it's so... it's so easy to want to be comfortable all the time and to like, and it's so easy in our society to be comfortable all the time, you know? And I mean, even like when you look at like the pandemic versus like World War I or something, you know, like we're all like bitching and moaning about watching Netflix when, you know, 100 years ago, people had just finished dying in the trenches eating rats, and then they come back and then there's a pandemic, you know?
I came back for this. Exactly.
So it's pretty well. But yeah, I thought that book was pretty cool. And it definitely put a lot of things in perspective, you know, but that definitely helped me to find a little bit more of a positive relationship with this this challenge that we're all currently facing. Were there any kind of moments where you were like, you know, I got this. This is cool. I'm like in a better place now.
Most of the time, honestly. I mean, you know, I know it hasn't been an ideal situation for a lot of people. For me, my life, I kind of lived under quarantine before quarantine. Like I went to the studio, I went to my house. I mean, I saw friends, but I was not really like out and about that much anyways. So it didn't have a huge effect on me in the way it affected other people, and that I wasn't like missing socializing. I've definitely been seeing people less and I miss my friends, but it's just not as dramatic of a change. And at the beginning, it was honestly kind of a relief, from the rat race of like the music industry and trying to keep up and like being like, where do I fit into like the EDM world? And everyone, there's all this stuff happening. And there was like harsh stop. Everything just comes to a halt. It was like, cool. I kind of needed like a breather, obviously not the circumstances I would have chosen for a breather, but you know, the world delivers what it delivers. So yeah. And I just kind of felt like, okay, I can kind of figure out what I want to do instead of like feeling like I'm in the middle of a race trying to plan at the same time. Yeah.
Yeah. I've been really, I've been really trying to look at it as a gift more, you know, even though it's awful and it has been hard and totally upended my life and stuff. But I remember, there was one day when I was talking to my wife, Nunik, and she was like, look, you need to start looking at it as a gift. The sooner you can shift your thinking to look at it as a gift, the more bearable it's going to be. But yeah, it was definitely, you know, it's definitely been pretty rough, but I'm glad to have finally made my peace with it. And I'm really pumped to get back out there on the road and play all these new tracks I made now, man. Yeah. Is there anything that you're looking forward to most about it being done?
I mean, I want to get out there and start playing shows. I feel like I had taken a break from playing shows. I really want to get back out. I miss being in the club and the rattle and just like the dingy hole in the wall places. Which is so weird to say because I feel like I became so jaded about that stuff and was like, I've been there, done that, blah, blah, blah. Like I was too cool for it or something. Then when it gets taken away, you're like, man, I miss that, you know? So I'm definitely looking forward to that and getting, you know, just, I think it's just that feeling of like, okay, like we're, you know, I've been getting feeling better progressively. Things have been improving, obviously, since the election and the vaccine rollout. I see the numbers, they're going up every day. You know what I mean? Like we are headed in the right direction. It's going to take some time, but that's fine. I can be patient now. because I don't, it's not like we're just castaways at sea, just trying to hold on to whatever we can. There's a plan, it's working, it's science. So yeah, I'm just excited to get back to that feeling of like, I mean, I feel like I've been a kind of like a quiet person. I want to go out to like a bar and like buy everybody a drink. You know what I mean? Like, I feel like it's in that way, it's been good. It's forced me to maybe push me to be a little more outgoing or something.
Yeah, I'm pretty pumped about it too.
Yeah.
Cool. So is there anything that you've learned recently that you'd like to share?
What have I learned recently? The thing I need to constantly remind myself career-wise and life-wise is the patience. Like I've been working on my garden recently, and I noticed how long, you know, it takes certain plants to grow, and some of the same plant I've been growing from avocado seeds. I have all these avocado seeds. What's up, turtle? Turtle's coming back. Just they take a while to grow, and some of them grow faster than others. And just like being like, okay, this is the way that nature works, whatever it is, whether it's a seed, whether it's your idea, whether you're writing songs, some of them are going to grow. Some of them aren't going to grow. Some of them are going to grow faster than others. Like to just be like, okay, this is how things are going to work. And to like, ease off. I tend to push forward. Like this needs to have, everything needs to be happening, you know, like there's this like success sort of promotion mindset that I think everyone who's in the entertainment world feels, where you just kind of constantly have to be promoting or creating content, you know, like it can be your least favorite phrase after a while. So
productive.
Yeah, totally. So anyways, I think I've just been learning to like, okay, just plant good seeds, good things will happen. Things take time. I'm an impatient person, you know. I tend to be very impatient. So I just need to learn and keep reminding myself. Like I said, it's like an everyday thing. It's not like I remind myself and then I'm like, okay, cool, now I can get on to other self-improvement tasks. It's like, oh no, this is like one that I'm like probably in my whole life going to be like, okay, just calm down, be patient.
Cool.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I think that's a great note to wrap up on.
That's good, right?
Where could people find you online?
Kraddyodaddy.com. I'm at, all my handles are Kraddyodaddy on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, and TikTok. Yeah, we just put out the remix of Like a Feather with Dylan's got a remix on there, and Champagne Drip and Opiuo, Bachelors of Science. So that's new. And we have Ian, Echo Zoo, and Kill Will. We have two more tracks that we've worked on. One of them, we just got the cover done. So that's coming out soon. And then a third one. So yeah, with this label Mother Wolf. Yeah. So I've got a lot of things in the works. Like this, the downtime has given me a lot of creative time. I've written a lot of music, which has been good. It's good for me to write a lot rather than try to write one good thing. I just write a ton of stuff. And then some of it's good.
Man, to that. That's
yeah, right. I know. I learned that a lot from you, honestly, from taking your classes. And you really talk about that a lot. And I always have to remind myself to just write a lot and don't care what it is, just write. It will turn out to be something, will turn out to be good, but you can't go in with the goal to turn it out to be good.
And I just like getting surprised too.
Exactly.
And having room for surprise. And when you're trying to do one thing, there's like so many things that you have to push away to make the one thing happen. Mm-hmm. So yeah. All right, word. Well, hey, lots of love and lots of love to all of you for watching / listening. Please go check out the single and be sure to follow Kraddy O'Daddy everywhere. Peace out. That's
all right, Communication. Peace, Dylan.